This conference will now be recorded.
Vakhada ajarya madhyamam asmada ajarya paryandam vande guru paramparam ragadi rogan sadata anushaktan asheshakaya prasrudana sheshan aulsukya moharadidan jakhana yo purva vaidyaya namostu tasmai. So we were talking about the Anubandha Chatushtayam in the context of Ayukamayamanena Dharmartha Sukha Sadhanam Ayurvedopadeseshu Vidheya Paramadara. In that context, we were discussing about Anubandha Chatushtayam, which we completed, I think. So we will continue. Actually, there are many things. We can go to any extent while explaining all these textual portions. But I think we will just move a little bit faster. Otherwise, it will be very, very time taking to complete one chapter, especially Ayushkamiyam. Ayushkamiyam is a chapter which is important in the sense that every aspect discussed here is about the swasapnas and paribhashas of the Shastra. Swasapnas and the paribhashas. The definitions and technical terms that are used in the Shastra are introduced here. So we can go to any extent. Ayurveda, we can talk a lot about Ayurveda. Ayurveda yadi, jnapa yadi, prakriti jnana, rasayana, duda, arishto, arishtada, arishtadi, upadeshada. So that is how Arunadatta explains it. Ayurveda yadi, jnapa yadi, prakriti jnana, rasayana, duda, arishtadi, upadeshada. Idi Ayurveda. So that can be elaborated further. And here there is a word called upadesha. Upadishyande ebhihi iti upadeshaha. So all textbooks, all literature comes under the purview of upadesha that way. And we are talking about Ayurveda. So there is a term called Ayuhu. 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 We have learned Ayu in many contexts. Eti satatam yadi. Something which is going. We are losing it continuously. Satatam. Continuously it is moving. It is going. It is, we are losing it continuously. That is actually the word meaning of Ayu. So we have learned Ayus in different contexts. We all know that Sharirendriya Sattvatma Samyogo Dhari Jividam Nityagascha. There is one word called Nityaga. So that is the real meaning of Ayus. Anubandhascha. Even though it is Nityaga, it is Anubandha. There is a continuity, maybe from our Purva Janma to the present Janma, and it is going to continue to the Janmas which are yet in the queue. So that way also we can find different shades of meaning for the word Ayu, Nityagaha, Anubandhaha, all these things. So, but I think we will not go to that extent. We will just move forward. Next is something about how this Ayurveda came to the present context. The present context means the context of this textbook. how this textbook was written or what is its relevance, how did this happen. All these things are mentioned in the next few shlokas. We will see it. Brahma smritva ayusho vedam prajapadima jigrahal soshvinau tau sahasraksham sotriputradigan munin tegnivesadigamstetu prathaktandrani tenire. Brahma smritva ayusho vedam prajapadima jigrahal soshvinau tau sahasraksham sotriputradigan munin tegnivesadigan tetu prathaktandrani tenire. So as per the document, the story starts from the level of Brahma. Story starts from the level of Brahma. Brahma smritva, smritva, smriti smaranam, recollecting, or it is something related with the memory, memorizing, recollecting. Brahma smritva, what? Ayushaha vedam, ayushaha vedam, ayusha palanam vedam. So Brahma recollected, memorized ayushaha vedam, and then prajapatim ajigrahad, he taught the vedam to prajapati. To prajapati, prajapati, there are many prajapatis, so I think we will not go to that details which are of maybe interest in different contexts, but we will take it for granted that Brahma taught this vedam to prajapati, and that prajapati taught these lessons of vedam, ayurvedam, ayushaha vedam, to the Ashwini Devas, Ashwini Kumaras. Ashwini Kumaras are also famous, Purana Prasiddha, as the Vaidyas of the Devaloka. Tau Sahasraksham, the twin brothers, Ashwins, they taught this Ayushaha Vedam to Sahasraksha, Indra. Satakratu, all these things are synonyms of Indra. Saha Atriputradigan Munin. Indra taught the Ayushaha Vedam to Atriputradigan Munin. So it is the juncture at which the knowledge is transferred from the Devaloka or Deva or that category of knowledge holders to Muni. They are supposed to be human beings or coming to the mankind. That is the juncture from Indra to Atriputradigan Munin. Te Agnivesadigan, they taught the Ayusha Vedam to Agnivesadigan. Agni, the Munis, the Maharshis, beginning a set of Maharshis beginning with the name Agnivesa, Agnivesa, and others. There, I think everybody knows that list of Maharshis who learned Ayusha Vedam. And Tetu Prithak Tandrani Tenire, Tenire, they authored, created, made Prithak Tandrani Tenire, they made Prithak, separate Tandrani, books, works, or texts. Actually, when you go through Ashtanga Sangraham, we can see that this method of authoring books started from the Atriputradigan Muni itself. It does not from the Agniveshadigan, but it starts from Atriputradigan Muni itself. Anyway, from that point, when it came down to earth, Bhumi, started scripting textbooks, started authoring works, maybe different reasons, in the Swarloka or in that divine sphere of existence, you may not require a textbook to recollect things. Maybe because of their higher intellectual capacity, maybe because of the lack of Rajas and Tamas, everything what you learn will be retrieved, retained as such, or even taken to the next level of understanding. But when it came to the human sphere of intelligence, then there is the threat of missing informations, losing the standard, the quality, and the meanings as well. So that could be the reason why it was started documenting properly. In Ashtanga Sangraham, there is one beautiful point. Grihitvate samamnayam prakashyacha parasparam ayayur manusham logam. The rishis learned this shastra from the Indra, and they discussed this between them as they understood. Prakashyacha parasparam. So there was some sort of a get together after completion of their learning process, maybe something like the so-called convocation or something what we call these days, and they discussed the points what they learned among themselves and made it a point that what they understood is clear and proper and perfect. For that, prakashyacha parasparam, then ayayur manusham logam. Then they brought it to the human sphere of existence. And the next line is more important. Stityartham ayurvedasya tetha tandrani chakrire. Atha te tandrani chakrire. They made textbooks. Why? Ayurvedasya stityartham. Stiti is to make it a point that this is not gone forever. The concepts are documented. Stityartham, existence. So the whatever you have learned should be sustainable. That information should be documented. Then only it will be, you can make sure that it is going to exist. So these days, it is a point of importance that you publish or perish. So that legacy of publishing, documenting, making things properly authored and published starts from the point where the Ayushaha Vedam came down to the human sphere of intelligence. Otherwise, nothing of these things, nothing original, will not sustain. So, Stityartham Ayurvedasya Tedha Tandrani Chakride. So, that point is given with due importance in Ashtanga Sangraha. That is quite interesting, I always felt. Stityartham Ayurvedasya Tedha Tandrani Chakride. So, it starts from Brahma. But Brahma Smritva, if I have to do the smaranam, the knowledge should exist before me. Then I can or I have already learned it from some other source. Then only I can recollect. The word used is smritva, not kritva. If Brahma was the first author or the beginning point of the Shastra, he should be the creator. He should be the creator. But here the word used is smritva. So the commentators have worked a lot on this point. Smritva, what does it mean? So sometimes it may be reflecting the point that Brahma smritva aisho vedam. So Brahma has four Vedas into his credit already. So he might have gone through all the four Vedas and later compiled those pieces, bits, tits of Vedic information or Vedic wisdom, rather I would say, and compiled the Ayushaha Vedam. So he has gone through an extensive survey of the four Vedas and he made this Veda by the Smarana of the four Vedas. So that may be one way of interpreting it. If you interpret it in such a way, you are giving some sort of a equality to Ayurvedam with the other four Vedas because it is not different. So that may be one intention, giving some sort of a credibility, some sort of a superiority to this Shastra. It is equivalent to the Veda. And Brahma has made it in such a way that he recollected all the relevant portions of Ayuh or Ayuh Palanam. And this thing was combined. That is one way of looking at it. Another thing is, as we saw earlier, it is apurva. According to our Indian knowledge tradition, one can see that most of this jnana is starting from the authorship of Brahma. So it doesn't mean that he created, he is not the creator, but Brahma is the point of emanation of wisdom. Whatever wisdom is there that can be converged to one point, and that point of convergence itself is known as Brahma. Prajnanam Brahma. So that need not be personified. Brahma need not be a person as such, but a point of emanation, a point of origin of all sorts of jnana. So that way also it can be interpreted. There are many such interpretations. Fine. I do not know how many of you will be interested in going through such details. Forget it. Doesn't matter. For the time's sake, we think that the Ayurveda has got its first known Acharya and his name is Brahma. He started propagating by teaching this Ayurvedam to Prajapati. Then that whatever sequence we have seen in the Shloka, that happened. And at one point, it reached the human level of existence, human level of intelligence. And from that point onwards, we started making textbooks. And all those who learned from Indra made Prithak Tandrani, separate textbooks. Because I have my own interest. I am interested in one speciality. So obviously, my text will be dominating the concepts of that speciality. So ultimately what happened is we have a handful of textbooks, but with a well-defined inclination towards different branches. So that is the way at which, or the point at which, we are thinking about something new. And that is explained as in the next sloka. Tebhyo odi vipragirnebhya praya saratarochaya kriyadeshtanga hrudayam nadi sankshepa vistaram. Tebhyo odi vipragirnebhya praya saratarochaya kriyadeshtanga hrudayam nadi sankshepa vistaram. So these textbooks, what these maharshis made, they were adi viprakirnam. That means very scattered. So if you survey one textbook, you will be getting many things about one speciality, but general concepts at large will be missing. Then you have to survey another work to get something about the missing points in the previous work. So that way, I think these textbooks were known as adivipragirnam. Adivipragirnebhyaha tebhyaha. These textbooks were adivipragirnam, and practically it was not possible for somebody to get a complete understanding of the Shastra by following any of these textbook. Sangraha mentions it in a very interesting way. Tesham egaigam avyabi samasta vyadhi sadhane. None of these textbooks were elaborating the approach which will empower a vaidya to deal with all diseases. Everybody has got their own interest, their specialty. So by learning one textbook, you'll be expert in one branch in dealing with the diseases of one particular area or particular type. Samasta vyadhi sadhane, you will not be able to. And if you then you have limited choice, you have to learn all these textbooks, then what will happen? Praditandra abhiyogedu purushayusha sankshayaha bhavati adhyayaneneva. By the exercise of learning all these textbooks, purushayusha sankshayaha, your entire eyes will be completed, finished, you're gone. So there were some that sort of practical difficulties of learning the science, the Shastra as a whole. That is the background in which Vaghbada is trying to make a comprehensive work on this, a very comprehensive work. So in Sangraha, it is told that Sarvatandranyada Prayaha Samhritya. So by surveying all these textbooks and whatever are relevant, they are taken. Then Asthana Vistarakshepa Punaruktadi Varjitaha. By avoiding unnecessary elaborations and elaborations which are not contextual, all those things are dropped. And Hedulinga Ushadhaskandha Trayamatra Nibandhanaha. By avoiding all unnecessary portions from this bulk and specifically focusing on Hedulinga Aushadha three factors, that Trisutra factors. Then Vinigudhartha Tattvanam Pradeshanam Prakashakaha. By giving or throwing sufficient light to make the hidden aspects of the Shastra clearer, स्वान्यतंत्र विरोधानां भूयिष्ठं विनिवारकः बाय मेकिंग द टेक्स्ट द ओरिजिनल स्टफ द बॉडी ऑफ द वर्क एज क्लीन एज पॉसिबल अवॉइडिंग conflicting ideas, contradictory points to the best level possible. Yuganirupa sandarbha. So it is some sort of a pradisamskaranam of the existing literatures. Vibhagena, with a proper work in which the entire stuff is edited and organized into specific categories, specific divisions, chapters or something like that. By that exercise, Vagbhada made Ashtanga Sangraha. In Ashtanga Hridaya, again, that is what the sloka, what we were seeing, Tebhyo Odi Vipragirnebhya Praya Saratarochayaha Adi Vipragirnebhya Tebhya Praya Saratarochayaha. Sarataram. Saram is the essence. Sarataram, essence of the essence. Essence of the essence. Uchayam. Uchayam. Uchiyande. Sangrihyande. Vikshiptaha. Padarthaha. Anena. Idi uchayaha. Uchiyande. So it is something like piling up or putting together, uchiyande, by putting the scattered things together, and those which are not essential are excluded, and some sort of a organized form is given. So prayasara tarochayaha kriyade ashtanga hridayam, ashtanga hridayam kriyade. I am making this ashtanga hridayam. How? Nadi Sankshepa Vistaraha. This is neither Adi Sankshepam nor Adi Vistaram. Adi Sankshepam, there are certain works which are Adi Sankshepam. The reader or the learner will not get the required stuff from it because it is so concise. Whereas there are certain other works which are Adi Vistaram. You will have to survey maybe 100 pages to see one point which you are really looking for. So they are adivistara. So avoiding that way of presenting. Nadi sankshepa vistaram. Neither adisankshepam nor adivistaram ashtanga hridayam kriyade. So that is the way in which this book is authored. So actually, it is again some sort of an inspiration for the learner. Okay, I have come to the real work which I was looking for all these days. If I learn this, this is very crisp, very concise, very precise, to the point, easy to learn. And if I master this small book, definitely I am going to master the art of Ayurveda, and definitely I will become a master healer. So that is the point of explaining all these things. From the great legacy which emanates from a point of pure wisdom called Brahma, or from an Acharya which is known to us, the first author of Ayurveda, Brahma, through a sequential transfer of knowledge, through the divine sphere of wisdom, then slowly coming down to the human sphere of wisdom, intelligence, application, practicability. Now, at this point, I have come to a precise work which will help you to master the art and craft of Ayurvedam uncompromisingly, but at the same time, it will not demand too much of your time to learn and master. So this is something like an inspirational note for the learner to come close to the textbook and master it uncompromisingly. Tebhyo odi viprakirnebhya praya saratarochayam क्रियदेष्टांग हृदयम् नादि संक्षेप विस्तरम्। As far as Ashtanga Hridayam is concerned, this can be regarded as the smallest work, but which is the most beautiful in the way in which it is presented, and the least complicated presentation, but all-encompassing. All-encompassing. We have got the works of later authors, which have got a well-defined inclination towards a certain speciality. Say, for example, Madhava Nidanam, you will be getting more about the Nidana Panchaka only. In Sharangadhara Samhita, you are taken to another field of speciality. If it is something else, you will be inclined towards another speciality of way of explanation. If it is Bhava Prakasam, you are going more about the Nikhandu part, like that. So this work, Ashtanga Hridayam, is very precise but all-encompassing, covering all the necessary branches and specialities with all the practical aspects. All other philosophical jargons and other aspects of unnecessary explanations are kept away. So this is a request to the learner that at least this textbook, you learn completely from the beginning to the end, so that you will be getting what the real Ayurveda is. Of course, there are works which starts from the work of Brahma, from the work of somebody else or somebody else downstairs, but at least they are definitely superior. They are shown a very, very extensive horizons or skies of Ayurvedic wisdom. No doubt about it. I do not contradict with that concept. But practically, at least you learn this work so small, so crisp, so precise, so sharp. At least this work you learn from the beginning to the end, maybe by a regular swadhyayam. So that also is included in this concept of tebhyo odi viprakirnebhya prayasara tarochayaha kriyadeshtanga hrudayam nadi sankshepa vistaram. Fine. And one more note he is giving about this text. That is what the next shloka is. Kayabala grahordhvanga शल्यदंष्ट्राजरावृषान् अष्टावंगानि तस्याहु चिकित्सायेषु संश्रिता कायबालग्रहोर्ध्वांग शल्यदंष्ट्राजरावृषान् अष्टावंगानि तस्याहु चिकित्सायेषु संश्रिता तस्य मीन्स् तस्य अष्टांगहृदयस्य अष्टौ अंगानि. It has got ashtau angani, eight angas, eight parts, eight avayavas, eight branches. Yeshu chigilsa samshrida. And this division of the text or the contents to eight parts is based on yeshu chigilsa samshrida, on the practical aspects of chigilsa. Chigilsa is the base. Based on that, this textbook can be seen to have eight angas: kaya, bala, graha, urthanga, shalya, damstra, jara, brishan. So these are the eight branches upon which my work is split into eight angas: kaya, bala, graha, urthanga, शल्य दंष्ट्रा जरा वृषान अष्टावंगानि तस्याहुः चिकित्सा येषु संश्रिता. सो द बेस इज चिकित्सा, चिकित्सा येषु संश्रिता. दैट इज द वन पॉइंट ऑफ कंक्लूडिंग द इंट्रोडक्टरी एरियाज ऑफ अष्टांग हृदय. नाउ दे स्विच ओवर टू द टेक्निकल एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ अष्टांग हृदय. Which we are going to see. Vayu pittam kabhaschedi trayo doshah समासतः वायु पित्तं कभश्चेदि त्रयोदोषाः समासतः. सो दैट इज ए स्टेटमेंट और ए प्रतिज्ञा. यू हैव टू टेक दिस स्टेटमेंट फॉर ग्रांटेड. We have gone through many discussions, debates so far from Brahma onwards, and we have come to the conclusion that there are trayaha doshaah, three doshas, vayuhu pittam kabhaha cha iti. Samasataha, briefly, in short, trayaha doshaah, three doshas are accepted and they are called vayu pittam kapha cha iti. So many things are introduced at this point, many things. First time, as far as a learner is concerned, for the first time he is meeting some very technical points. We do not know what this vayu is, what this pittam is, what this kapham is, what this dosha is. So nothing is disclosed, but all of a sudden certain technical terms are introduced. So what we know already is what we have started from the sloka that athata ayushkamiya adhyaya, and when we explained that atha and ataha, we already saw that after achieving or after going through the preparatory syllabus or preparatory text regarding the various darshanas, various philosophical schools, or whatever is required, all those philosophical schools are something like a pre-Ayurvedic lessons. So the concepts regarding many ideas like gunam or whatever we see in very detail in Charaka Samhita, that Shatpadartham, then Vimshati Gunas, all these things are basically introduced before coming to the lessons or the teachings of Ashtanga, sorry, Ayurveda. So with that background, we come to this, and all of a sudden, some technical terms are introduced. Vayu, Pittam, Kaphascheri, Trayo Doshaha. Trayo Doshaha. So the most important word here is Dosha. Doshaha. We should have a basic understanding about what this Dosha is. If you go through different lexicons or Nikhandus or that sort of works, we find that Dushyate iti Doshaha. Dushyate iti doshaha. Dushyate, something which can be subjected to dushti. Something which can be subjected to dushti is known as dosha. So that gives one basic idea about the technical term called dosha. It can go through dushti. It can be subjected to dushti by some factors, some nidana. They are, by and large, they are called nidana. So something which can be subjected to dushti is technically called as dosha. Dusha vaikritye. That is from where this word is nishpannam. Dusha vaikritye. So that tendency to get to accommodate dushti. That is the word dosha, what originally it reflects is. Another one, what we learn later as part of our Ayurvedic understanding is dushana subhavad doshaha. Dushana swabhavad. So that dushana swabhavam means its capacity, the capacity of that principle called dosha. the capacity to make something else dushtam. So primarily, it receives or it becomes dushta by the influence of samnidana. Dushyate iti doshaha. Secondarily, dushana swabhava dosha. Once it becomes dushta, it has got the capacity to make something else dushta. That dushti is transferred to the next level. Dushana swabhavad doshaha. So these two things are to be kept in mind. Dushyate iti doshaha, dushana swabhavad doshaha. So such a principle is called as dosha. Again, doho. Doho. That is another root from which you can make the word called dosha. That doho means hand, pani, hand. Damyadi anena. Damyadi anena. Damyadi comes from dam, dam upashame. So something with which you can regulate, you can control, you can take over something is known as here the upashame. Damyati. So it reflects the capacity of the dosha to control all other bodily activities. As if a driver or an operator operates the entire system with his hands, the same way dosha. The principle called dosha or doshas regulates that yandram of sharira. That way, the word dosha comes from a root which has got the meaning hand. Dos, doho, damyati. So that also is very important because that reflects the regulatory capacity of the doshas. The first two meanings, number one, to receive dushti itself by the influence of nidana. Number two, the capacity of the doshas to transfer the dushti to a second level, dushana swabhavad. And here, the capacity of the doshas to regulate a system, to work as the regulatory principles of a system. So these three meanings are to be kept in our mind while we hear, while we listen to the word called dosha. And interestingly, trayaha doshaha, three doshas are introduced. Vayuhu, pittam, kabhaha cha iti. Vayuhu, pittam, kabhaha cha. So by names itself, it is very clear that only three are the vayu, pittam, kabhaha, cha. Everybody knows that only three. Still, a word trayaha is included. That is for reinforcing the concept that there are no four doshas and two doshas are not sufficient to explain the system. So, in order to fulfill the ideas what we were trying to with the concept of dosha, we need three, not four, not two. So trayaha, by reinstating by the word trayaha, some sort of a reinforcement is done that there are three doshas and you have to take this for granted in further learning of this textbook. You are not supposed to get confused with any other ideas regarding doshas. And samasataha, briefly, in short, because the same dosha can be seen explained as vriddha sometimes. And the same dosha can be seen as explained as sama. It can be seen explained sometimes as kshina. regarding vruddha itself, sometimes it can be seen as vruddham, sometimes vruddhataram, sometimes vruddhatamam. Regarding kshina also, we may find kshinam, sometimes kshinataram, sometimes kshinatamam. Again, at one point, you may find the same dosha divided into five subtypes. So, while you go or come across that portions of the literature, you may have a doubt that why do you stick on to three? There are many subtypes possible, and if you do not take them as subtypes but as types, you can find maybe 20-25 doshas. So why should you stick on to three? So that is the beauty of this concept. That means, in spite of all those subtypes possible, in spite of all those subcategories possible, ultimately you can focus them, you can converge the idea into these three points of entries called Vayu Pittam Kapha. So Vyasataha, when you elaborate Vyasataha, there may be many doshas, there may be many categories, but Sankshepataha, Samasataha, in short, precisely, they all come under three headings, Vayu, Pittam and Kapham. So the concept what we are going to present here is something like a magic key wherein a huge building having hundreds of doors permitting entry to hundreds of rooms, all can be opened by three chavis, three keys. So he is introducing a magic concept. The entire body can be operated with these three keys. Vayu Pittam Kapha Cha Idi Trayo Doshaha Samasataha. What is the significance? Next line tells us, Vikrita Avikritaha Deham Khnandi Te Vartayandi Cha. Vikrita Avikritaha Deham Khnandi Te Vartayandi Cha. Vikrita Avikritaha Te. These three doshas, Vikritaha and Avikritaha. Vikritaha, Avikritaha. Vikritaha, Vikritam, Vikritam, something which has gone or departed from the prakriti is known as Vikritam. And Avikritam means something which continues to be in prakriti is known as Avikritam. So there is a negative notion used more frequently. Instead of prakritam and aprakritam, he is using Vikritam and Avikritam. That is a very purposeful usage. It is not an accidental usage. It is a very intentional usage. Because, as we have seen earlier, the word dosha itself shows its tendency to get departed from the prakritavastha. That is what we have seen. Dushyate. The word basically, the root itself reflects dushyate iti dosha. So with the simplest possible carelessness, the simplest possible carelessness, doshas tend to get into dushti. So to keep them in prakritavastha, avikritavastha, lot of effort is required. Whereas to keep them departed from the prakritavastha, no effort is required. That is why it is intentionally used as vikrita and avikrita, not prakrita and aprakrita. So vikrita, avikrita, vikritaha ghanandi, avikritaha vartayandi. Vikritaha ghanandi, avikritaha vartayandi. Viknandi. Viknandi annihilates, kills, spoils, destructs. So vikrutaha doshaha deham khnandi. Avikrutaha doshaha deham vartayandi. Vartayandi sustains, maintains, helps to continue. Pravartayandi. So avikrutaha vartayandi, vikrutaha khnandi. So these words, these usages, actually they reflect the concept of dosha in a better way. In order to keep the body in pravritti, in vritti, you have to put a lot of effort. That is why this shastra. You require a lot of care to maintain the vehicle properly. If your intention is to spoil the vehicle, the best option is to just leave it as such. The nature will take its course. The vehicle will start rusting. The oil will start clogging. The engine will start damaging. So no care is required to spoil things. But to keep the vehicle in perfect condition, you need care. In the same way, to maintain the sharira, deha, to reach the natural course of termination of sampurna ayu, you need to put a lot of effort. But in an aparva maranam, in an untimely end, you just have to invest carelessness, nothing else. So that message is given in this usage of vikruta avikruta while explaining the vayu pittam kapham. Otherwise, it could have been explained very, very differently by Vagbhada. Vagbhada, the name as shows, is the bhada, is the soldier of Vak. So using a better word was not at all a challenge for him. He is Vagbhada. But intentionally, because of his Vakbhada, he made it like Vikrita Avikritaha Deham Khnandi Te Vartayandi Cha. So I think by this introduction to dosha, we will stop here because we have got only 5 more minutes. If we have a couple of points to discuss, we will take that. Okay, Nilesh.
Yeah, yes, sir. Surely. Thank you, sir. Sir,
there is one question who are different Prajapatis, but I think I'll not go much into it. There are 11 Prajapatis explained.
Yes.
Yeah, 11 Prajapatis explained in the Puranas. So I think better you refer to that context. Including the Daksha Prajapati. 11, if I'm right, there are 11 Prajapatis explained. I think there may not be much doubts about this because all this is something like listening to a story, no?
Yes.
But the concept of dosha.
Small announcement.
Yeah, just 1 minute. The dosha concept should be learned very, very thoroughly, very deeply. Why it is dosha, why it is vikruta, why it is avikruta, why these words are used, what is the real crux of intention, why it is used in such a way. All these things are very important because, see, to get an answer from a modern science or a modern allopathic portion, you will have maybe hundreds of papers published, you will have hundreds of sources available. So each one of us attending this Ashtanga Hridayam seriously should be the persons who are supposed to answer any queries about Ashtanga Hridayam or Ayurveda in the days to come. We have only a handful of people, whereas the Western system of medicine or the so-called universal system of medicine has got millions to answer the queries, millions to work on the different aspects, and millions to make the system move forward. We have only a handful of people, and we have got plenty of literature which are yet to be properly commented on, which are yet to be properly explained. So everyone who is serious about Ayurveda should have a thorough understanding about each and every line, every word used in our literature. So I think Ashtanga Hridayam should be or could be the best option because it is so handy. So at least from Ashtanga Hridayam, every serious learner should have a thorough understanding why it is the word dosha is used, why something else is not used, why this way of explanation comes. And don't believe in Shastra. That is one another request. Don't believe in Shastra, because what this textbook what we are getting right now has gone through a time period of maybe 1500 years. So print, non-print, handwritten manuscript versions, many things could have happened, many things could have been added, many things would have been deleted, missed, misinterpreted, misscripted, wrongly scripted. So we should have a very curious mind about every word and sentence, and while learning to the core and with uncompromising dedication, meantime we should be able to get, we should be get ready to get dissected also. There should not be, Shastra does not require any sympathy from us. Shastra never seeks any sympathy, any mamata. Please protect me, please protect me. Shastra never tells like that. Shastra is existing just because of its mere capacity to exist, capacity to survive. It is not because of our mercy. So you need not be inclined towards protecting the Shastra, but you should be very curious about doing pariksha on the Shastra. Doing pariksha on the Shastra. So that is very important. It's a request. So Nilesh, please continue. You have to pass over some message.
Yeah, yes, sir. Day after tomorrow, on Friday, we are having our 100th session. So I'll convey the message through WhatsApp and Telegram groups. That was the announcement to make. Yes. One question is there, sir.
Okay.
Shall I read it?
Yeah, please.
Yes. In Charak, there is the explanation of Lokapurush Samya Siddhanta. Does it play in the case of origin of Ayurveda, as Brahma, Ashwins, etc. are all in this universe and in our mind to each individual?
Yeah, that is true. That is true. Because see, as I told earlier, you will be getting a complete idea about all these things when you survey all the literature. When you go through Charaka Samhita, when you go through Sushruta, Kashyapa, you will be getting different perspectives of the same idea, different viewpoints of the same idea. So definitely we can go through all these points and take the message home. No doubt about it. But right now, in this context, many of such things are kept away. And as Vagbhada tells, that Sarataruchayam, Ashtanga Hridayam is supposed to be the Sarataruchayam. The Loga Purusha Samyam is supposed to be the core concept of evolution of Ayurvedic principles, I would say. Because above and over mystifying the concepts, Loga Purusha Samyam gives you a very, very methodological and physical comparison possible between human mind, I'm sorry, human body and the universe. So that is more logical, and that is more philosophical as well at the same time, because there you are coming in some sort of a perfect tune with the great concept that Aham Brahmasmi. So there is no difference between me and Brahma. So Brahma Smritva Ayushaha Vedam, precisely means the concept is there, hidden, embedded in me also. So I am part of that great wisdom, the universal wisdom which Brahma represents. So I am a point, a molecule of that wisdom. So I can be a part of that Brahma wisdom, and I can project myself to that level. In the same time, the entire universe, the entire prapancham, the Brahma, has come to one point, one nucleus, and is focusing in my wisdom. So that is a very beautiful concept, and I think that should be highlighted as the best ever part of the philosophical wisdom or the philosophical platform of Ayurveda. No doubt about it. But while dealing with Ashtanga Hridaya, we were trying to explain what Vagbhada has explained or Vagbhada has tried to highlight. That's all.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I think there are no more questions. So can we conclude, sir?
Yes, we can. We can. So thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a wonderful day.
Yes. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you all. Have a good day.